welcome to Kryton Live on Fuse Logic TV. I'm your host, Michael Kryton, and today, a really, really wonderful story for me, a connection to a very old friend from my youth who has now become a published author in conjunction with his colleague. Today, we're going to take a look at something very interesting, stories that are not necessarily told that involve the Celtic culture in a beautiful epic fiction that has been published by Mike Harding and his co-author, Monique Conner, Kindling A Celtic Heart, published by Author House and available at Author House and Stillwater Books and Art, and we'll share that information throughout the show. I'd like to welcome them. Mike Harding, welcome to the show, and Monique Conner, thank you for joining me. Monique Conner is from New Jersey. Mike Harding comes to us from Campbell River. How are you guys doing?
I'm doing very well, Mike. Thanks for having us.
Thank you for having us.
I've had a chance to talk to Mike, of course, at length in the weeks leading up to this show, and I let's just jump right into it. The background to this book's development is quite interesting. It's a 500 and I believe almost 66-page epic, a blend of fact, fiction, myth, and speculation that focuses on Celtic, on the, sort of a Celtic context that reaches into many things. Tell me about the background to the book's development, how you guys got together.
Well, it started out, Monique and I met working on a website, a writer's website, that was basically set, the milieu was set in 300 BC. And she was a very talented writer, and we hooked up at some point and began to create a storyline that eventually became the basis for this book. The website no longer exists. It was called Empire of Ashes, but the book it comes out of that. Effort from a lot of people.
And what was the experience from your context, Monique? What was interesting about the way things developed for you in the early stages?
I just like the fact that Mike and I seemed to blend so seamlessly together when it came to the writing.
That's true.
We both had the same kind of mindset on where we wanted to take the characters and where we wanted to take the book. And we both seemed very interested in the history of the time period.
Now, there's two things that we look about, because there's a bit of Celtic and there's a bit of African. And of course, Mike, it's your connection is to the Celtic. The main character is Athelstan, who is a warrior that is going through a tremendous process after upheaval where he was, and he ends up far away from where he began, and it's a process leading to triumph. But Monique, yours is the history of African Kush, which is the character that you had a lot to do with it, which is Kadashi. Can you tell us a little bit more about Kadashi and African Kush?
Well, Kadashi actually is the name of my very best friend. It means queen. So I started to do some research on the Kush culture just based on my own personal interest in that. And that's how she progressed. And it just seemed to flow nicely together when we hooked Athelstan up with Kadashi. They seem to have a chemistry all their own.
Just out of curiosity, how long did it take you to write the book?
Yeah, probably a year, maybe a little more. The notes were being taken probably a year before we actually started to compile a novel. But the novel itself probably took about a year and a half. Monique, was that be about right?
About a year, yeah.
So
lot of long nights.
A lot of very long nights, yeah.
So the characters of Athelstan, Mike, I'm assuming that there's a lot of you in the character, the main character of Athelstan, and I would assume then also, Monique, that there's a lot of you in the character of Kadashi, is that right?
I don't see me and Kadashi at all, but from what Mike tells me, I'm very much like her.
Well, Kadashi 10 in the book is an extremely stubborn lady. She can out-stubborn pretty much anyone. If we look at Athelstan, certainly his belief system is very much like my own. The way he deals with people is very much similar to me, yes.
Now, what we need to do is tell us the story. Give us the overview. What is Kindling of a Celtic Heart about? Tell us a brief overview of the story.
Well, it begins with Athelstan and his people living in northern Italy, and they're being forced out by the expansion of Rome. They migrate to northern Macedonia, but he is sent to Sparta by his king to elicit help in order to reclaim their homeland, Spartans being some of the most feared warriors at the time. When he gets there, he runs across this girl, and basically everything goes to heck in a handbasket from that point on, because she is such a dynamic person. He hooks up with her, and they travel to Athens and meet up with some of her people who have been waiting. She's in exile. And from there, she's actually looking for much the same help for a situation in Kush that Athelstan is in Italy. And he actually convinces her to come to northern Macedonia to petition his own king for help, because they have one of the largest standing armies, the Celtic people, in existence in that day. And with that weight of warriors, they would be able to certainly take care of the problem in Kush. Events take place throughout this book that actually propel Athelstan to kingship. And that is, in an essence, the book. But there's a lot going on, a lot of things going on, aside from the fact that he begins to fall in love with Kadashi and she with him. And it's a very interesting dynamic.
And that actually takes us into the next sort of segment of the show, in which we're going to dive a little bit into the book and some of the essences of what makes it what it is. You're watching Kryton Live on Fused Logic TV. My guests are Mike Harding and Monique Conner, who are the co-authors of Kindling of a Celtic Heart, available at Author House and Stillwater Books and Art. A beautiful blend of fiction and fact, and also a context that begins in Celtic culture. And let's go to that. One of the, as I understand it, this is book one of the Forging of a Celtic King trilogy, dealing primarily with the Celtic culture of 300 BC, which I think is interesting because I don't think there's a lot that does. How did it differ? How did that culture differ from the classic culture? I'm talking about the Celtic culture. How did it differ from the classic culture of, say, the Greeks or the Romans, which is what you do tie into the book? What are the differences there?
Well, I think initially the biggest thing is that it's a much older culture. The Celtic people are probably 2,000 years into their history by the time this book begins. And they have very strong sense of chivalry and honor and devotion to one another, to family. They will not, for instance, accept abuse of the weak. And they are very black and white people. It's either right or wrong, good or bad. And you're either a friend or a foe, and you really are a foe at your own peril. And they are a brutal people, but amongst themselves, they're actually quite gentle. The Greeks and the Romans had a much different structure. They had a dictatorial-type structure, where the Celtic people did not. While you might be a king or a queen, they had no distinction between men and women. Women could be anything they wanted to be. They had the druids and whatnot, who were really the lawgivers and that sort of thing. So the structure was very different.
Let's dig down a little bit more. You set the book in 313 BC. Now, can you explain why you chose to place it at this time in history, both for the Celtic people and the people of Kush?
Well, I think for both of us, Monique will correct me if I'm wrong, there is very little history between the death of Alexander the Great in 323 BC and the real basic rise of Rome around 300 BC. So we stuck it right in the middle to give us a little bit of literary license. I know Monique knows a lot more about the Kush people, and maybe she can talk about that time period in Africa.
Yeah, let me ask you, Monique, tell us a little bit about that culture in that time frame.
Well, from what I understand and learned about the Kush, it's basically very similar to the Celtic people. They had kings and queens. It was more of a co-regent kind of situation where the king and the queen shared their title together. When Mike was talking about how the shamans tend to rule the law, that was much like it was in Kush. The time period in this history at this time is very kind of unknown because most of the history that's been learned about Africa is all Egyptian, and Kush kind of took a shadowy figure to that.
That's really interesting. I mean, this book is so rich, and there are so many aspects, and I know that we can only go through so many in the course of this show. One of the things I'd like to, of course, writing a book like this is about storytelling, and one of the most charming parts of the book, there's around page 131 to 135, there's a storytelling sequence around the flute, and I know, Mike, that was particularly special to you. The importance of storytelling in those cultures, how important was it?
Well, it was very important. The Celtic people didn't have a written language of their own, unlike the Kush, who used Egyptian hieroglyphics, but with a different language. They had no written language at all. if they had to write something down, they would use Greek, but they never wrote their stories down. They were always passed down by a verbal tradition. And usually it was the bards that would do that, which was one of the steps to becoming a druid. So they would have people wandering around from tribe to tribe telling histories, telling current events, often in the form of poetry or metaphor or song. So it was extremely important. It was a hinge pin that kept the Celtic people sort of linked as a common group.
Now, in the history, I mean, there's different aspects of the book that are really fascinating. And I look, for example, when we look at the adventure component of the book, there's a scene, a mountain scene, in which they're crossing a mountain pass. Typically, we think of Hannibal and we think of some of the historical passes that have occurred. But what is interesting about this particular sequence, which occurs around page 354 to 362, is the tremendous detail. But what was fascinating was the relationship between the characters and the horses, for example. And maybe share something around that, because, again, you seem to bring in these contexts that, in a way, it's almost as if you had been there. It was very, very real in terms of what would have happened there. So maybe share a little bit about the mountain scene and the importance of that in terms of the adventure of the book.
Well, first of all, the people of Kush would never have likely seen ice or snow. So it was a very alien world for them. The actual scene itself is taking place on a land bridge between two mountain peaks. You make a point that it's something that was visual. I mean, you could really see where it was. It is, in fact, something that I have seen, a mountain bridge like that. I live in British Columbia, so I don't know if that actually exists in northern Macedonia. I've never been there. But I just inserted it, and once the story began, it just flowed. I mean, that's how Monique and I write. Once we start going, we feed off each other, and it just pours out of us like we've sprung a leak.
Did you guys ever end up in some serious debates?
No, never. I don't remember us ever ending up in debates. We tend to present, I present my side, he presents his side, and we find a compromise in the middle if there's something that we don't agree on.
Well, I would have to say that certainly is reflected in the book, because there is a tremendous harmony in terms of the romance of the characters. I'm speaking with Mike Harding and Monique Conner, who are the co-authors of Kindling of a Celtic Heart, that has just been published by Author House, a 566-page epic, a beautiful book that for those of you that enjoy Celtic history and Roman history and the landscape of what went on, it is a wonderful read. In the next segment that we're going to go to, we're going to take a short break to watch something that in and of itself is a story. We're going to talk about, of course, when we think of the Celts, we think of Druids, we think of magic and mysticism, rites and rituals, and we're going to talk about that. But what we're going to do is we're going to take a listen to a song performed by a Celtic woman called Scarborough Fair. And Mike and I had an interesting chat last night. You go down to the street and you tell anybody who wrote Scarborough Fair, and for those that certainly are in our age bracket, would say, well, that would have been Simon and Garfunkel. But that's far from the truth of what that song is about. Michael, can you share us the history and the story of Scarborough Fair?
Well, this goes back to the whole oral tradition. For the longest time, stories were told from father to son and from son to grandson and so on. This story itself probably is 500, 600 years old at the least. It has changed considerably up to the point where Simon and Garfunkel got a hold of it. But originally it was a story about an elf who wanted to kidnap a mortal woman to be his lover. And he would do so if she couldn't perform an impossible task. But as it usually turns out with strong-willed ladies like Monique, she in turn gave him a series of tasks to perform that were equally as impossible. And it's actually a very long story. They've only used little bits of it for Scarborough Fair. But I would say that the first recorded writing of this story was about 500 years ago, which would lead me to believe that it's probably much, much older than that.
Well, when we come back, we're going to deal in or delve into magic and mysticism and look at that side of the book that we are talking about that has just been published, Kindling of a Celtic Heart, with Mike Harding and Monique Conner, who are the co-authors, published by Author House. And now what I would invite you to enjoy is the current version of Scarborough Fair performed by Celtic Woman from her album A New Journey on the Manhattan label. Enjoy. A beautiful performance of the song Scarborough Fair that has a much greater history than we realized, performed by Celtic Woman off her album A New Journey on the Manhattan label. We are talking about, and it all relates to this book, Kindling of a Celtic Heart, written by Mike Harding and Monique Conner, who are my guests today. And let's carry on. Let's move into the world of magic and mysticism. Now, many of us have heard of things like the Oracle of Delphi. Did the Celtic people also use prophecy or mysticism in the same way the Greeks did?
Oh, I think so.
Mike, if you could hit your video button for us, we've lost your video.
I don't know where it is.
All right.
Oh, here we are. Okay, there we go. Sorry about that.
No problem.
How's
it's
that?
Internet there. Television as opposed to publishing books.
But that's okay.
There you are. Okay. All right. So tell me about prophecy and mysticism in terms of the Celtic context versus, say, the way the Greeks experienced it.
Right. Well, the Greeks had the Oracle of Delphi. Very few Greek commanders would go into war, for instance, without consulting the Oracle. This was generally a lady who was sitting in a volcanic fume and usually pretty stoned, and she would just pronounce yes or no, go or die, or, you know, be like that. The Celtic people relied more, I think, on seers, like people who would who'd use prophecy. Psychics, I guess, would be a great example of that. And very often, to be a psychic, you are also a druidess, very much a learned, wise woman type person. And when they would profess something or read something to you from the spirit world, you would actually pay very careful attention to it, because these were so much were actually words from their gods. That's how they looked at it. So it was different, yes, but they both operated kind of in the same fashion, where they would take their cue from the spiritual world in order to do things.
And the involvement now, how did you incorporate some of that into the book itself?
Well, early on in the book, Athelstan meets two ladies who are twins, and both are druidesses. They are so well connected that they actually, when they speak, one will start a sentence and the other will finish it. And this is how it goes. And they're both psychic, and they can both see the spiritual world. And he actually gets a reading from them, where they warn him that Kadashi is in his future.
Actually, and I believe the druids are casting a spell on our technology. So if I can get you guys to hit your video buttons again,
right.
You bring your picture back. Obviously, they're trying to somehow disguise you, I would suggest. Now, in terms of rites and rituals, you also have that, of course, appears in the book as well. Now, specifically, am I pronouncing this right? Is it Samhain or Samhain Festival?
It would be the Samhain Festival.
Samhain Festival. Tell me about the Samhain Festival. You use it. You use several rituals, in fact, but one in particular, this one, is near the end of the book. Can you explain this fall event, and did the people of Kush have similar events?
Well, Samhain Festival is actually what it turns out to be is a Halloween. It's one of the oldest festivals, I think, that's known today. Hang on, I'm going to hit this button again here and see what happens. It incorporates a lot of mysticism as well. The Celtic people believed that the veil between the living and the dead was the thinnest on this particular day, so your ancestors could come and visit with you. Very often, they would put a meal out and leave one empty chair for a departed relative. They would put masks on to keep mischievous spirits from recognizing you. They'd carve turnips, for instance, into faces, or hollow them out and put lanterns in them and hang them in the trees. This is all thousands and thousands and thousands of years old and comes down through the mists of time.
Now, maybe I can ask Monique, did the Kush have similar festivals to your knowledge?
Yes, the Kush did. They worshipped the god Amun-Ra and his wife Munt, and also the god Parti, which is the god of water. So living in the desert and in Africa, it gets very hot. Water is the livelihood for them. So they had festivals where they would give praises to Amun and Parti based on when the Nile flooded and became more fertile. So they had those kind of festivals.
Now, let's... Obviously, there's the romance in the book between the two characters finds its way to some sort of resolution, but maybe we don't want to give away too much and let people pick up the book and read it. But this is part of a trilogy that you're developing. Is there anything you can tell us about where this trilogy is going to be going?
Well, I wanted to initially, when we started this book, to give the impression and the sense of who the Celtic people were. Very little is really known about them. If we look back in history, probably we'd come up with about 100 pages of actual documented stuff about the Celtic people. So what I wanted to do was give the impression that they are a very gentle people. They're a very kind people for the most part. Sure, they fight amongst themselves, and it was a warlike nation. It was a pretty brutal time. But when put upon, when pushed, they could be absolutely grim. And book 2 and book 3 will examine that in a little bit greater detail. the end of the book, I'm not going to give it away, but an event happens that throws Athelstan into an absolute mindless rage. And he's been dealing with a group of people that he knows nothing about, and they have basically pushed him to a point where he's going to turn around and push back, but he doesn't push back. He's going to shove, and it's the story will continue from that point, and the journey will take him, in fact, to Kush, and into central East Africa.
And if I also might say, I know you was touching on the romance part. The romance in book one is actually kind of like a love triangle. When as the readers read it, they'll see that there is more to the relationship between Athelstan and Kadashi, and there's an additional figure in their romance that is kind of like this figure that's constantly looming, but not in a negative way. Although there is a negative looming figure, which people will read that, but there's more of a love triangle for the story.
Well, I mean, the scope, when we think about the history that you've engaged, there's a lot more to be revealed. And I think that one of the wonderful things about the book, in my opinion, is the fact that it does embrace the Celtic culture of 300 BC. I mean, I've studied things like the history of English, and I've had a chance to sort of follow a culture back. But generally, when we get back there, we think of things like the Romans. And in fact, in the book, there's a very interesting section that describes the Roman military structure, something I never had seen before or understood in terms of the way they structured their armies and their troops and that sort of thing. So the detail in the book is amazing. Michael, if you'd like to bring up my, or sorry, Evan, if you'd like to bring up the my laptop, this is the site for Stillwater Books and Art where you can order the book. And I encourage you, as it reads on the website, Kindling a Celtic Heart examines the classical world from the totally new perspective of a Celtic general sent to secure help from Sparta in turning the tide of Roman expansion into northern Italy. This tale asks the questions, who were the real barbarians? Maybe as a closing discussion, that's an interesting question. Who were the real barbarians? Because it's quite true that I think that there would be a more... Am I correct in saying that there is a more common perception that the Celts were barbarians?
Yes. The story that I read, that I think I believe, comes from Julius Caesar himself. When he first met the Celtic druid, Vercingetorix, they didn't speak the same language. And Gaelic is an extremely guttural kind of sound. And the way it was described was that Caesar actually started to laugh at the way that this Celtic person was talking, and he made the sound barbar, 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 because that's sort of how it sounded. And the term barbarian grew out of that. Then the connection between the brutality of what a barbarian is grew from there. but in terms of brutality, overall brutality, I think... the Romans certainly set that bar pretty high.
Absolutely, absolutely. I have a question from one of our online participants. Where would one even begin to find out more about the Celtic people and culture? That comes from Hunter. Thank you very much.
Well, there are a number of books. There is a very good book by a gentleman named Philip Carr Gome and John Michael Greer called The Druidry Handbook. And another one... probably, in my estimation, the most definitive work, Peter Beresford Ellis, called The Druids. These two books examine the Druidic faith, but they have to, in all honesty, touch on the Celtic people and their culture and their civilization. Two wonderful pieces of work that I've used as research material. Now, there's also a lot of archaeological work being done. Another book by Anne Ross and Don Robbins called The Life and Death of a Druid Prince is a phenomenal piece of work. What they have done is uncovered in the bogs a druidic prince who underwent a ritual execution in order to secure good crops and whatnot. They had a very different way of looking at life. Since they didn't fear death, they had the sense that you were born, you lived, you died, you were reborn. In fact, one of the things that really caught me was the fact that you could owe somebody money in this life and pay them back in the next.
Oh, there's so much depth and history to the Druids. And, of course, when we say Druid, we automatically think of the Stonehenge. I'm afraid we've run out of time, but I would like to thank Michael Harding and Monique Conner for joining us, the co-authors of Kindling of a Celtic Heart. It is available through Stillwater Books and Art. If you go to stillwaterbooksandart.ca, you can order your book there. It's been published by Author House. Mike Harding and Monique Conner, despite some technical glitches, I don't think it matters because stories are stories, whether we can see the faces or not. Thank you so much for joining me on Kryton Live today.
Thank you, Michael.
Thanks for having me.
All right, don't go away, anybody. We're coming up with the debut episode of A Brilliant Idea Every 60 Seconds. You're watching Fuse Logic TV. Be sure to join us on the online chat forum for that as well. I'm going to be joined by my very good friend, Don Norris, who is also the host of Brandvertising, as well as superstar copywriter Troy White from Calgary. Stay tuned. Thanks for being with us, and have a creative and perhaps a Celtic day. Thank you.